Somebody should get the photo up here of the hats and the pink and the alums and the knitting, and it's really just kind of awesome. So as I'm sure many of you know, I can tell we have lots of alums in the room here today. It's very easy to be a very proud Barnard alumna. Barnard alums make discoveries, they change minds, and they change the world every day in thousands and thousands of different ways. And we are here tonight to speak in particular and learn from the extraordinary Krista Suh, class of 2009, who has changed the world in a very special, memorable, hot pink kind of way. Krista and her friend, Jana Zweiman, had a simple idea. An idea that's so perfect and so brilliant that as soon as you hear about it and see it, you know how special it's going to be. Their idea was to make a pink knit pussy hat that could be recreated with enough ease and little enough money so that it could truly become ubiquitous. A pink hat that could be worn to say something important and unifying without using a single word, and as a bonus, could keep heads warm in the dead of winter. A pink hat that would, in a very short period of time, become a symbol recognized across the world. This is really hard to pull off. People have ideas all the time. Very few of them catch on the way the pink pussy hat has. I predict to you, I tend not to want to be in the prediction business, I predict to you, this thing's never going away. 50 years from now, people are going to know what the pussy hat was and is. This is going to become a symbol of women, of power, of creativity, and of political change, all in the shape of an awesome hat that's also really nice to wear. So I have to say that I have the great luck that one of our students volunteered to make my hat for me. So a shout out to Zach. I don't know if Zach's in the room, but thank you. I received my hat, I put it on, and I didn't take it off for about 2 days. There's something special about this hat. It makes you feel good to wear it. It makes you feel good to be part of a movement. It makes you feel good to be walking around the street and symbolizing something that really matters. And I just want to tell you my two very, very quick personal anecdotes. The day of the march, sadly, I could not be in DC because I had to fly to London. But as I was walking around, sort of just doing my last minute errands, I saw one of these great New York scenes. It was a couple probably in their late 70s coming home from Whole Foods, you know, sort of laden down and grumpy, and it wasn't a great day. And the woman was wearing a hat, and the man in his 70s, grumpy, holding bags, was wearing the pussy hat. And I thought, now that is something special. The second moment, and I'm sure many of you had this same moment, was watching on my phone, as we all do now, this beautiful montage that I believe the New York Times had posted of aerial views of all the marches. And you looked at those photos, and it brought tears to your eyes, because not only were there thousands and thousands of not just women, people in the street, but that they were wearing something that let you know what it was about. And that sea of pink, in all the colors of pink, and the unity around pink as a symbol of change and power and empowerment is really one of the most powerful visual symbols I've seen in a really long time. So we are here tonight to learn more about this movement, to learn more about the women behind it, to learn more about what lies ahead. And we are incredibly lucky that we have Krista here with us this evening. She and I, we've now been together 2 weekends in a row, which is great. And she is extraordinary, and it's great to celebrate her. But we also are lucky to have some other members of our community and our extended family here with us today. Special thanks to the always amazing Professor Joan Snitzer. Joan was influential as a teacher and a mentor in Krista's life, as she has been in the lives of hundreds and hundreds of Barnard students, faculty, and alums. We also are delighted to have with us here today Brittney Bailey, manager of Purl Soho, and Pearl Chin, owner of Knitty City. I'm guessing that all knitting shops have to have puns in their name somewhere. And our beloved moderator, Professor of Art History, Anne Hugonet. Thank you to you all. Welcome back to Barnard, and thanks for being here. I am now going to turn it over to Krista.
Hi, everyone. I feel so welcome here, especially seeing all these pussy hats in the audience. Thank you. You know, I've been thinking a lot about what the pussy hat really means to me. And whenever I see it on someone's head, I hear the phrase, "I got you." And I hear that when I most need it, and in every sense of the word, that You guys have got me. If I fall, you'll catch me, and you understand me, and you are emitting that wherever you go when you wear the pussy hat to everyone. Thank you so much. I want to start off by saying that Barnard was not an afterthought to this project. Like, it wasn't like, oh, like, one of our students, something great, we need to, like, really promote it or something. I mean, Barnard was so instrumental to this project, to my thinking behind the project. President Spahr started here when I was graduating, so we overlapped by just enough for her to make a deep impression on me. She wrote an article, I haven't told you this yet, but she wrote an article that I read about how women, she predicted it 9 years ago, that women were very isolated in their struggles and needed to band together politically in order to affect change. Joan Snitzer was my mentor in the arts department, even though I was pre-med, and I think she sensed before I did that I didn't want to be pre-med, so thank you, Joan. Professor Anne Lake Prescott, she was the one who told me, Krista, you are a writer. And I heard that at a time when I really needed it, that I wasn't able to call that of myself, but she called me that, a writer. And Barnard is just so near and dear to my heart. The best way I could describe it is that, you know, you come into college and you want to do all these amazing things, and they're like stars in the sky, right? And I feel like Barnard, like, brought that sky here, where I could just do things. I could try things. The Pussyhat Project, some of you might have visited the website. We've updated it with a few photos from the march. It's something really special. And when I was given the opportunity to speak here today, I didn't want to come here as an expert. I wanted to come as an artist who's trying to figure things out. So, I mean, we're talking about a symbol today, and I just want to address, like, right now, the symbols around me, where I'm on a stage, I'm at a podium, I'm literally like higher up, and there's this temptation to grab these symbols and be like, yes. Look at me, I'm amazing, and if you do things the way I did, like, you too can start a viral movement. And that's really, it's really tempting to do that, but I made a promise to myself that I wouldn't come up here and say that I was special. And this is why. There's this idea of the exceptional woman. And the exceptional woman is something that the patriarchy has created. The patriarchy needs an exceptional woman to show that, no, we're good to women. Look, we've got, you know, this spot here for the exceptional woman waiting for you if you just try hard enough. And if you just do things the right way, if you're nice enough, feminine enough, strong enough, and once you get to do that, you get to be the exceptional woman. Like, and I think I was so competitive and so ambitious when I was young. I played that game, you know? I was like, I'm gonna try and try and try. And I said to myself that I just, now that I have some notoriety from the project, I don't wanna come here and say, I did it, I became the exceptional woman, and now you can too, et cetera, et cetera. Like, I don't wanna play that game, I don't wanna be a pawn in that game. I don't even wanna be a bishop or a queen in that game. And the reality is, like, I didn't create the Pussyhat Project because I followed the rules and I tried hard. And no, the reality is I followed my intuition, even when it looked really weird and frivolous and people were like, really? Like, you know? I followed my intuition. I didn't listen to a lot of rules. I tried to listen to myself. And I think it worked, you know? So I don't wanna come here now that I have some notoriety to say that, like, I don't wanna gift this project to patriarchy after all this. So then again, it, you know, it's tempting, you know, to be like, I'm important now. But the thing is, I had an idea. And I like to think that makes me really rare and special, but it's not. We all have ideas. We all have really, really great ideas. We have that spark. I think if there's any difference is that I've spent the last 10 years learning how to nurture my ideas and unlearning how to squelch my ideas. And I think that latter part is really, really important. And when I talk about squelchers, squelching, these agents of squelch, I think we all have them, right? It's like when you have an idea, and you're like, that'd be cool. And then a squelching thought comes in, like, I don't know. Like, is that kind of stupid? Is that kind of frivolous? Do I really have the time to do that? I have all these other obligations that are more important. We all have our own version of it, but I think you know what I mean, right? And I think especially for women, we're taught to nurture everything but our own ideas. And we're taught to squelch our ideas because honestly, it makes us more accommodating people, right? Like, so I want to come here today to share that I really hope, if anything, from my being here, you learn how to nurture your own ideas and to value them. Because I could have easily talked myself out of this, and I'm so glad I didn't. I've talked myself out of lots of ideas in the past. And I'm endeavoring to be better at not doing that. So I want to get more into like how to not squelch ideas. So there's that initial point where you're like, I think I have an idea, and all these internal things come up, right? Like, and even more scary is asking someone to join you. So I have this fear of rejection that I had to overcome or at least work with. And, you know, early on I asked Kat Coyle to design the pattern you see on the website. I asked Jaina Zweiman to come on board to help me make this a reality. I asked Aurora Lady to illustrate those beautiful pamphlets you see before you. And I love Aurora. She helped us show a visual of what the sea of pink looked like before it happened. I mean, that's the power of art, right? It's the power of an artist. So I want to go a little more into asking, and that my personal fear of asking is if I ask and they don't want to do it, they say no, I'm afraid that I'm going to be a demanding woman. I'm afraid that I'm going to be seen as annoying and inconvenient. But it goes beyond that, right? Because we have this subconscious, irrational thing where it's like, so this is how mine goes. Krista, if you ask and they say no, you'll be seen as an annoying woman, and you'll be disliked, and then you'll be ostracized from society, and then you'll die. So with that running underneath all my thoughts, it's like, it's no wonder it's kind of hard to ask people to like join your movement, right? And something I've had to work on a lot, I mean, I'm a screenwriter in LA, it's a very collaborative medium, and I had to slowly work on that thought and kind of tear it apart. I would love to show you, so when I reached out to Aurora, I sent her a really long email. And just outlining everything. And I also sent her a video like outlining what I was hoping for that she could do to volunteer her skills for. So I'm gonna play a little bit of that for you. And feel free to laugh at my at my drawing, it's fine.
Page where we're talking about the why, so to speak. The pattern I'm gonna be getting from Kat later.
All right, so this is the front page. You could compare it to what you have in your hands.
Hi, Aurora. This is what I was working on. Obviously, we need a real artist, but this would be the first page. And, you know, something showing the hat, probably on a woman, and like White House, different DC imagery to like, so people understand, can connect it to like the politics of it in the march. This would be the second page where we're talking about the why, so to speak. The pattern I'm going to be getting from Kat later today, and I'm thinking actually some of the, this is like the how, and maybe like the pattern's going to be pretty short, so maybe down here we'd have room to say like, okay, make the hat, send it here to this address. So yeah, because right now this page two is getting a little crowded, so maybe page three would include making of the hat and sending of the hat. And the last page, Jaina had this really great idea of like sort of illustrating the process of it, like even showing how the hat is like a rectangle and you fold it.
So as you can see, the final product looks a lot different from this work in progress. And I think it can be really scary to show someone your really bad drawing. And I want to use this as an opportunity, though, to talk about how the birthing process isn't pretty, you know? And when it's not pretty, it's even easier to talk yourself out of it sometimes, right? Like, but I think part of being an artist, it's taught me to get more comfortable with the process. When I was at Barnard, I was still like, my dream was to just, anytime I had to learn something, my dream was to be a hermit and go to a mountain and like practice and come back really good at tennis or whatever it would be. Like, you know, I didn't want anyone to see me struggle. And I don't know, I think embracing creativity and being able to ask for help and in a way that you, where you don't feel shame about yourself, I think is really important. So anyway, that's a little bit of behind the scenes of how the project came together. And I want to talk about this fear. Like I mentioned earlier that like it's not a small thing when you're walking around holding yourself in because you're afraid if you speak up you'll die, right? I don't know if other people have that internal dialogue. I certainly wasn't aware of it for most of my life until I really sat down to think about it and all those steps. It's like, yeah, what was it? Demanding, disliked, ostracized, die. So like to unpack that, think of how powerful you can be if you let that go. So a few years ago, I was a mentor at a ropes course for a group of inner city kids. And a ropes course is like a trust exercise, a team building exercise, where they put you in a harness, they put you high up, and you like walk on a tight rope, and you like jump from rope to rope, all very high up. And I personally love heights, I love it. Like, and so I was just really psyched, but a lot of the students were really scared, and I was really struck by what one of the instructors said. He gathered us around, and he said, what you're about to do, this ropes course, it's scary, but it's not dangerous. And I just was like, what? Like, this is such, what, like, I, at the time, I was working on a book, and I was really scared about releasing it and, you know, getting people's comments on it and stuff. And when he said that, I was like, oh my God, like, releasing a book, it's scary, but it's not dangerous, right? I'm not gonna die from releasing a book, hopefully, thankfully, right? And I think when it comes to speaking up, I feel like, I'm just gonna hazard a guess that a lot of us have these fears, these idea squelchers that tell us like, don't do it, just, it's better not to say anything or suggest that or speak up. And I want to suggest to you all that there's these two camps, scary and dangerous. I think most of us are in the camp of scary, where to speak up would be scary. But there are women, there are people out there that to speak up, it would be dangerous. And in order to change the world, those of us in the scary camp, it's our duty to speak up. Because the more we do, the more we face our fears that are merely scary, not dangerous, we can make the world a safer place, including for the people where it's now currently dangerous to speak up. So the next time you feel like shrinking, think about not just yourself, but about the women where it's dangerous to speak up. You know, when I had this idea for the project, I was like, wouldn't it be great if women in red states knit these hats, like, you know, subversive knitting, like right in front of their like Republican townsfolk and whatever. Oh my God, like, actually it still makes me smile. And we did, we got hats coming in from all over the country, all over the world, including the red states of United States of America. But there is one story that really, it kind of sobered my thinking, where we got a hat, there's no return address on it, and she wrote, I'm sorry, I'm not writing an address. I made this hat for the Women's March and in secret, and I had to bring it to the post office in secret because I'm afraid my husband will find out. So it's not just women in far-flung countries, it's women here that we have to speak up for. So I do have some, I've always enjoyed talks that had concrete tips to it. Like actually at Barnard a few years ago, well, when I was a student, Glamour magazine had a panel here, like advice from women in their 30s, 40s, 50s, and Kathleen Turner was here. She has that really deep, raspy voice, so really sexy. And she gave the best advice. She was like, well, whenever I go out, I always add 20 minutes to my travel time. And I'm sitting there thinking, oh, that's smart. Like, you know, that way you're never late or whatever. But she had such a diva, like, addition to that. She's like, I always add 20 minutes to my travel time in case I run into a fan. And I was like, oh my God, like my mind was just blown. Like, and I've always carried that with me. And sometimes I'll like just sort of like kind of tease myself like, oh, add another 20 minutes. What if you run into a fan, you know? So my sort of concrete tips for you are some affirmations that I found really, really work. So in regards to people, I had this thought in my head, this limiting belief that people say no to me. And imagine if you have that thought, every time someone says no to you, it just, you know, confirms it, right? And when people say yes to you, you're like, oh, that's just a fluke, right? So if you reverse that, which I did, like, I just started saying to myself, people say yes to me. And it was beautiful, because if I got a no, I was like, that's a fluke. People say yes to me. I'm going to keep going. So it really, really works. And honestly, I think people do say yes to me more now, so... I'm a comedy writer, and sometimes when I can't think of something, I just don't feel funny. I'll just like sit there alone in my sad room being like, I'm hilarious. And just like how lame that is actually makes me laugh, but then makes me feel hilarious, and I start writing again. So just sometimes you just have to loosen up your thinking, right? Another favorite of mine, and this is actually really useful in the long road ahead, where you know, I'm tasking you today to speak up, but there will be times when it's like, you kind of miss your moment, and you're like, damn it, like I should have said something, and, or you say something, and it's dismissed, and you're like, what, you know, or you're ignored, and it'll feel icky, but it doesn't mean that you failed, and what I like to say in those moments is, I'm a panther in the dark. It's you can laugh, it's fine, but but there's that moment where you're like, all right, they didn't see me, but that's on them, and doesn't mean I'm nothing, it doesn't mean I'm weak. If anything, I'm a panther in the dark. I'm powerful. They aren't seeing me. I'm gonna choose my moment to pounce. So I gift that to you. You know, when I was at Barnard, I was such an introvert, and I was so afraid of going out into the world and doing that thing called networking. And, you know, people at Barnard sort of taught you how, but it didn't really click for me. And I had two tricks. Hollywood is all about networking. Whenever I entered a room of new people, I would picture everyone with my grandmother's face, because whenever she saw me, she would just light up, like, and she loved me having me there, so I would picture that. And I also had this affirmation, almost a prayer, you know, that I would say when I was younger, just fresh out of college, and it really addressed every single moment of interaction that I had fears about. And so it goes, when people see me, they smile. When I speak, people are eager to hear what I have to say. When I leave, people think of me fondly. So I kept saying that to myself until it became true. And honestly, it feels a little bit weird to talk about affirmations. It's very LA, very spiritual to talk about them here in this like hallowed institution of academia. but I'm telling you, it really works, and I want to offer that to you. And to go back toward what I was saying about the exceptional woman, I really hope that you break free of that trust board, because if we all do, we can really affect change. And as long as you're playing that game, I think you'll always be told, like, that you're not enough, that you're not nice enough, personable enough, smart enough, you weren't assertive enough, and that's why whatever you're trying to do didn't work or whatever, right? And I want to tell you right now that you are enough. And I hope you say that to yourself a million times. And, you know, I said earlier that the Pussyhat to me, they're saying, I got you. Another thing they're saying is that you are enough. So I'm going to leave on that note. And thank you so much for letting me ramble up here. I really appreciate it.
I'll start by saying that I couldn't agree more with everything you said.
Thank you.
Might as well be teaching 101. So let me start here at the beginning by asking you, Krista. Oh, first of all, I need to make sure you all know who everybody is. I'm Anne Egonet, and I teach here at Barnard. We have Brittney Bailey, who manages the marvelous Purl Soho. We have Purl Chin, who is the founder and owner of our own Upper West Side knittery. Joan Snitzer, our marvelous studio teacher. And Krista, in case you didn't get that over the last 20 minutes. I'm used to just shouting at my students. So I thought I would start at the beginning and ask Krista, when was the beginning? I first heard about this idea from a network of knitters, I would say a week after Thanksgiving. But I've always wondered since then, when did you first have this idea? Did it come to you like a lightning bolt? How did it begin?
So if you think back to the week of Election Day, I know there's some memories there to dredge up. I'll keep it short, but I was really devastated on Election Day and the next day. And so when news of the Women's March came up, I knew immediately that I wanted to go. But I wanted to do something more for the march if I could. And I was racking my brain. I was remembering Joan Snitzer's teachings of how to communicate visually. No, this woman, she lined us up in painting studio and would like march up and down, and she was yelling. I'm sorry, but you were yelling at us, like, you must learn how to be visually literate. Like, you know, like visually literate. And, like, so your voice was in my head. And so I was thinking, what sign could I hold up? What could I wear or do on my body, my personage? And I meant it. Like, at the time, I was saying, like, I would strip naked for this. I just don't know what it is I need to do.
Then you thought of something warmer.
Yes. That actually was part of it, where I was like, maybe you'd strip naked in L.A. Like, would you do that in D.C.? And I was like, okay, I have to rethink, you know, wardrobe. So I was actually on a road trip with my family. We were celebrating their anniversary. my parents' anniversary. My parents actually went to Columbia and Barnard, by the way, so. And we were on a road trip. It was that Saturday, so November 12th. And I think there's something about being on the road and being a little bit disconnected from home where my juices, my brain juices were really flowing. And yeah, and from that moment of like, it's gonna be cold in DC, I thought, just really idly, like I could knit myself a hat. I'm a beginner knitter. My grandma taught me when I was very young, but it was sort of a dormant skill. And I got really obsessed with it last summer, again. And you know, I figured if I could make this hat, anyone could. And that's when that lightning bolt effect happened. Like, I could see the sea of pink. I could see people able to participate, even if they weren't physically there. I was really excited about it this Saturday, and I immediately texted Kat Coyle, who owns a little knittery. And I mean, looking at the text now, I'm a little embarrassed because it's like it's really enthusiastic. It's like, I just had a great idea, and like emoji, like you know, and so on. And I told her I would come when I came back in town. I would go to the store to talk to her about it. And you know, I talk about idea squelching, and I think. For me, the magic wasn't so much in the idea itself, but the fact that I didn't talk myself out of it in the next 3-4 days. And we met up on a Wednesday. The team did it in 6 days, which I actually love working like that. I love just throwing myself all in. And we launched the day before Thanksgiving. So you found out very soon after.
Well, okay, yeah. that leads right to my questions for Brittney and Purl, or the first of many questions. Which is, what is it about the knitting networks that you're a part of that, now that we know the date of the beginning, made this catch on so fast? Why were people knitting by 2 weeks after your idea launched? And I think you've both experienced that in your stores.
Certainly. Well, I've always felt that. One of the wonderful things, one of the best things that ever happened to knitting and to handcrafts in general was the internet. Historically, knitting is a matriarchal tradition. It's something that we learned from our mothers and our grandmothers. But when everything went online, we didn't necessarily have to depend on that. So if your mother or grandmother wasn't a knitter, if you weren't around someone that had the time or the ability to teach you those skills, you could jump onto YouTube and in half an hour, you have that. In the knitting world, we have a wonderful online community thanks to a little website called Ravelry that has, I think, over 3 million users now. And so we're really used to using the internet as a way to communicate and a way to connect with one another. And yeah, I think that's part of why it really jumped off. And then once everyone heard about it, I know I heard about it from a fellow coworker at Purl.
And how fast was that?
I think it was probably the week after Thanksgiving as well. And once we knew about it, the website just sat up on one of our desktops in the back of the store all the time because people were coming in asking.
Coming in asking. Absolutely. Is that true for you too, Purl? Were people starting to come in asking?
Well, what happened was, you know, let's see, after the election, you know, people in the store were very distraught about it, a lot of them. I, you know, this store is located on the Upper West Side. So, so you know, it stands to reason we have a lot of knitters, and we have big communities of knitters. We have, like, the men's group. We have our regulars. We have our book club. We have all of these different groups, various groups in Knitty City, and a lot of them had a... And a lot of them started knitting. It's like, in some ways, we should thank Donald for the anxiety he created among knitters that they are coming to the store to knit or to find something to do. Okay, the Pussyhat Project, I found out about it by, I was on Instagram, and Kay Gardner from Mason-Dixon Knitting, she had posted a picture. And where's Kay? Is Kay here?
Okay. Hi!
And Kay had posted this, and this was right around Thanksgiving, and I thought, you know what, this is the perfect metaphor. Knitting is therapeutic, and that's why people were coming in. But they needed to have some sort, something to kind of grasp on, you know? And at that point, it kind of started slowly. I told Nancy Ritchie right over here, I said, you know what, we're going to support this project. And so we started to have knit-ins, you know, on Tuesdays from 1:30 to 3 for people who wanted to come in. And then we started selling yarn. At first it was slow, and we got a lot of slack from it. You know, we posted on Instagram and Facebook, and you know, even a few of our customers, you know, thought that it was
pushback.
And yep. so then people started doing their Christmas projects, and there wasn't any time. But right after Christmas and the holidays, I mean, people were showing up all the time. We had knitters in the store, and it was just crazy busy. And my job on Mondays was to order pink yarn. That's all I did, was to order pink yarn and keep it busy.
Okay, so we're after Christmas. Mm-hmm. The stockings have been opened, okay, and everyone in post-holiday euphoria. And how fast did things start to happen, both of you?
I would say the first week of January, it really started to take off. And I know we were discussing before the panel just how much yarn we're talking about.
Yeah, how much yarn are we talking about?
So I don't have any specific numbers, but I know that I would say by the second week in January, we were overnighting boxes of 50 at least daily from our warehouse in California. I would close the store at 7:30, and on the subway ride home, I would be texting our warehouse manager in San Francisco saying like, okay, I'm gonna need another 50 more skeins, like can you get them here overnight? And they would be packaging them up and sending them out. And by 4 o'clock in the afternoon, we were out of pink yarn again. I mean,
what you found too, Purl?
Oh, definitely. Let's see, the other, it was a total influx. We'd get it at the beginning, you know, during the week, and then it'd go down, and then we'd get some more, and then it'd go down. And it was constant. People knitting. And I think in January there was the urgency of the march, so people knew they had to get it done. And then while they were doing them, they'd made hats for themselves, and then slowly they started making hats for their family members. One wonderful thing about this pussy hat metaphor was I think it kind of softened the march and it made it family friendly. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And you know what, we saw a lot of kids, and at first I was inking my number, you know, in case I was arrested or, you know, I needed some emergency number contact. And that was not necessary. That was not necessary at all. It was the most peaceful demonstration. And I felt like during the election, there was this huge gray cloud that covered my head. And then during the march, I felt that cloud just slowly, not dissipate, but it was just a little bit less dense. You know?
And Joan, I want to ask you about that sort of magic translation between the extremely material quality of the hats, this pink yarn that people make with their own hands into something. And how does that turn into an abstract symbol? You're an artist, and can you tell us a little bit about what it takes for raw matter to become a symbol?
A symbol in general, but this particular...
This is a symbol too. There is something about the craft and using the hands, and as long as we have hands, we're going to want to use them, and we're going to want to make things, and that was a very attractive part of this project. Also that it's fairly easy and fast to make, and I think in this project I made a hat and I couldn't make just one. As soon as you finished, you wanted to start the next one and the next one, so it had that aspect.
But that feeling that you could do things so fast. That you're really accomplishing something.
You could accomplish it, you could make something, and it was very funny to make. It wasn't like making a utilitarian object that was a necessity. It was this humorous object. It was bright pink. It was something you wouldn't in the past dare to do or say or make if you were a lady, and this was just so much fun.
I do have that question for all of you about the word. So I told my father I was doing one of these, and he just said, please, not the word. But you see, you're laughing, which is so great, because I want to ask all of you where the humor comes in, and whether like you had customers who came in and said this is funny. And did you think this was going to be not just powerful and affirming, but also humorous, which is a great turnaround? And are symbols better when they're positive and funny?
Not necessarily, but in this case, to really be able to reach a large audience, humor and irony always softens the blow. I don't think the message was any less serious, but but it was easier to digest with a little bit of humor added in, and it was easier to make a commitment to the project, being able to just smile a little. And I think even for the opposition, it was easier to understand because it was clever and funny. I think everybody likes to smile.
And Purl and Brittney, did you have customers who came in and said, I want to make the hat?
I think one of my favorite things, I don't know if you found this to be true, Purl, was watching people come through the store and the way that they asked for it. You had people come in and they were like, I'm here and I want to make a pussy hat. And it was like they were declaring it through the middle of the store and it was this big deal. And then you had the very like proper, often older customers that came in and were like, hello, I'm here to make a pussy hat. And they like quietly, you know, it's like, and I was like, it's okay, we know. It was just so fun to watch people and the way that they, their relationship to the project, each person's was different. One of the things that I loved was we had a lot of mother-daughter pairings come in and husbands and wives coming in and knitting them together. It was so fun to watch families work on the project as a group. It was very fun.
Purl, did you have couples and families and friends and sisters come in?
We had brothers. You know what? We posted a lot of this on our Facebook and our Instagram pages, but it was just refreshing to see all these families come in, you know, and also, you know, in the parade and stuff. I think overall, you know, when we started passing out the hats, right, it was like about 500 hats that we actually gave out. Mm. And this is not counting the people who bought the yarn and who, you know, who were passing it out to their friends and family. This is the extraneous ones. And once we got a bunch of hats in, they're gone. Now, after the march, people are still calling in and they want to have a hat, and we say that, I'm sorry, but all the knitters are knitting it for their family and their friends, and that's what's happening now.
The waiting list.
There is a waiting list.
Yes.
So in Los Angeles, I work as a joke writer, a comedy writer. So I do think that mentality is infused in these hats because comedy, it brings people together and it's de-escalating. And I also think it's very empowering because, like, the best way to assert power and say that I am not hurt by you is to laugh. And so I think there's something about wearing a hat, reclaiming that term pussy, and saying that, like, no matter what you do to us, we can laugh and we can make things and we can show up. That we aren't, like, I think to succumb to it, we wouldn't be able to laugh. So it shows that we haven't succumbed. And I also want to actually thank the knitting community that came out today, because I'm so new to the knitting community. And I think the knitting community, the crochet community, the fiber arts community, they're so inclusive. Like, you know, you're brand new, and they're like, come on in, I'll help you with that, a bind off or whatever. And I think that's such a good metaphor for what we can do politically, that like the crafters can teach us how to bring a large group of people together and teach each other. And I have a quick story about that where I was so new. Jane and I took lessons together at the Little Knittery. And Kat Coyle was our teacher. She designed the pattern for the original Pussy Power hat. And we were there, like, having lunch one day. Like, we were just eating before we were going to start reading tacos. And this yarn distributor was there chit-chatting with Kat. I think her name was, like, Janet or something. And when Kat went to the back of the store, Janet turns to us, and she's just like, Kat is a really big deal. You don't even know. And we're just like so shocked, because like we were so new to the community, we had no idea we were around like a celebrity knitter, and like Kat was like really instrumental in getting the word out to the knitting community early on. So, and she's very humble. She never told us like, do you know who I am, or whatever.
Well, speaking of giving and the inclusiveness of the community, something I've been very struck by is the idea that you make the hats not so much for yourself, but to give them to other people. And I wonder whether, to you, whether that was a part of the whole symbolism of it, the turning around and making it affirmative that there was a giving component. I'd like to know, Joan, what you think the symbolism is of the giving. And I'm wondering whether you can confirm for us that people thought of part of the project as giving the hats away.
So I love getting gifts. That's like, anytime I date someone new, I make it very clear. Like, gifts are welcome, often. But I think there's, like, my grandmother used to make knit me slippers, these red slippers. It was her own pattern. And I treasure them. It's, I think, like, hand making a gift and giving to someone, you're pouring your heart and soul into it. And it's that level of care that you're handing over, not just like the cloth itself, but like the hours and love you put in it. And so I think from the start, we wanted that feeling of community. And I think like a lot of people give them to friends and family, and it strengthens that bond. But we are really excited about the idea that a stranger in a red state could send it into DC and it would get to a marcher. And they might not know each other, but they would have that connection.
Listen, I was at the DC march with a group of women, and we were approached by someone with a plastic bag, and she pulled out four hats and said, "My aunt in Brooklyn knit them," and she said, she told me, "Go to the march and give them to strangers."
This particular project in the symbolism, that it is a very old craft that has been assigned to the women's gender, and that I'm another one that's grandmother taught me how to knit. And then I was reintroduced to it when I was pregnant with my daughter, Julia, by Dean Dorothy Denberg, who's here tonight.
A champion knitter, if ever there was one.
And I was very frightened new mom, and Dorothy brought me to the Barnard Club, knitting club, and there was a group of women sitting around knitting. So I think there's a community about knitting that's very strong, and it does make you feel safe. And then in today's time, to receive a gift that's handmade, that each stitch was loved and done, that has a very special feeling. You can't just go buy it on Amazon. In fact, you can't buy these hats on Amazon. You have to. They're not for sale. Thank you. Somebody had to make that hat, and you know that making that hat meant something personal. And that is another aspect of this project that's extremely compelling.
Purl and Brittney.
The giving.
I love that you included. I love that you included the tags, so people cut out the tags and they would attach it to their hats, and then you hear all these wonderful stories about how they don't know these people, but you know they really felt connected in some ways, and you know it's true. You can't buy this. Mm-hmm. You know, it's something that has to be given. I was afraid in the back of my mind that there would be some enterprising people from China who are going to be putting out pink hats. People would be buying them from stores instead of receiving them, you know, in this way. At the end, we had to tell people to, you know, just go ahead and buy pink hats and put pom-poms on them or something. You know, what they want is the visual symbol of the pink. But, I mean, it was really nice that you saw how these people were passing it on, and it's nice when you knew who the giver was.
I agree. I think from what I heard from our customers, it was probably about a 50-50 split between people that were knitting for people that they would be marching with or their immediate friends and family, and then those that were knitting to donate to the march, which was really great. For me, on a personal note, I never have time to knit for my friends. I'm always really busy teaching my students and working. And so I went down to the march and I knit, I think it was a total of 9 hats for the 9 women that I would be marching with. We went to grad school together, we're all very close. And for me, and I think about it a lot because knitting is my life, I'm very aware of the fact that even this project that's really quick, it's really labor intensive and time intensive, way slower than if you're just gonna like sew something or obviously buy it. And the act of taking the time to knit each one of those hats and thinking about the women that I was making them for while I was working on them and then giving them to them and standing around with them for hours and hours and hours waiting to march and then realizing that there were so many women around us that we could not, in fact, march was just such a beautiful thing. And I felt like, and I always feel like this when I knit a gift, but especially with this project, just being able to cover the people that I love literally with warmth and protection is just such an amazing thing.
Well, what a great note on which to ask all of you for your questions. So in the interest of seeing you all better, I'm going to stand. And because this way I really can, like, in the pink.
In the pink.
In the pink hat.
In the pink hat.
In one of the great pink hats. I have knit from your book.
Thank you. And we, now I'm yelling. We blogged about this, obviously, and one of the most moving things for me was to come home from the march Saturday night very late, get up in the morning, open my apartment door, and see the New York Times. Like, I almost wept, and maybe it was just because I was so tired. But... as a lifelong knitter, to see knitting getting, you know, such attention, and then the New Yorker and Time. And so my question, I guess it's for Krista, is somebody documenting all of this? Because it's going to be in the Smithsonian, you know, and it should be. And we need to get somebody on that if somebody isn't.
Yes.
So that's sort of my statement and my question.
Thanks, Kay. Such an honor to meet you. She's also very big in the knitting community. I've been better schooled since.
Another exceptional woman.
So we've had 6 different museums reach out to us to put Pussy Hats in their permanent collection. One of my favorite museums in the world, the Victoria and Albert, is going to have a Pussy Hat. And you know, I don't have, like, to my knowledge, I don't have a single person documenting it. Actually, Professor Ibanez is doing an amazing academic piece on it. But what's really amazing is I think it's gotten so big that I don't need to, like, collect everything, you know? It's a part of us now. But certainly there are a lot of documentarians who are doing things and have reached out to us. I'm Asian American. I'm half Korean, half Chinese. And I've said a lot, actually, that early on I decided not, like, if the Pussyhat Project is my child, my baby, I decided not to be an Asian tiger mom about it. Like, I would tell the project, like, as big as you want to get, like, I'm proud of you no matter what, like, you know? And I think it works, so if I ever have kids, I'll have to apply that thinking, I think. But, so certainly there is documentation going on, and I'm excited. My parents have tried to tackle the documenting. I think they're overwhelmed, but...
I think we had another question in this direction. Yep. Wearing a scarf here. Yep.
I'm going to let you keep it. I'm supposed to let you keep the mic so I don't steal the airtime. But I guess my question is, I have a lot of friends who are trans, trans women, non-binary, trans men. I think the movement, you know, we've been talking about women, we've been talking about gender, and then pussy obviously is tries to euphemism for genitalia that is aggressively associated with the women, female gender. And I think if you're going to start, you know, a movement and create a symbol like you're talking about that's for women and for, like, women's empowerment, et cetera, I just was wondering if you could speak to the choice to really stick with the gender essentialism of, like, pussy and associating that genitalia with women and the aggressive gendering of, like, based on biological notions of biological sex, especially because in your beginning talk, you were saying how if you have the power to speak up when it's not dangerous for you, it's just scary because you want to make it easier for people who it is dangerous for. I think the women who it's most dangerous for to speak up are trans women, and a lot of them are feeling, I'm not trans, so I can't speak for them, but I have been reading what they're saying, and they're feeling excluded by this symbol. Yeah. Have you heard that? What are your thoughts?
As the moderator, let me bounce that into a question for the panel. Does anyone actually really have a pussy, or is pussy, or is pussy a symbol that even men use around each other? I take your point totally, but I also wonder whether pussy may not have become a code word for any kind of weakness or vulnerability on the part of anybody.
Yeah, I would love to address your question, and I love how you framed that, because that, first off, I do think the word pussy is used to call anyone weak, and it is associated with female genitalia, so it's actually a slur not against being female, but being feminine. And I think in this world, like, yes, we still divide gender by these biological parts, but I think before we can get to a point where we no longer do that and that we're more gender fluid, no matter what, we have to respect the feminine more, because right now it's not. It doesn't matter if it's femininity in a woman or a man or a genderqueer person or a trans person, it's attacked. Like physically, emotionally, verbally. And I think to reclaim the word pussy isn't about literally like the vulva and the vagina and all that. It's also about reclaiming what it is that femininity is as valid as masculinity. And having said that, I do think that there's this great book called Pussy by Regina Thomas Hauer. I don't know if anyone knows it. But she talks about how like women aren't even given words to describe that literal body part. You know, there's vagina, but for her, that's not as, like, it doesn't encompass that part. And for her, pussy has become to mean more like the divine feminine. I mean, she has a lot of great theories. But I do think it's interesting that women have all these shameful words for that part. Like, I hear, you know, down there, or, I mean, there's all these words, right? In the meantime, so people with vaginas, reproductive sex organs that are female, we aren't even given language to talk about it without shame. In the meantime, there are legislators, often male, legislating about that actual body part. So yes, it's symbolic, and yes, it refers to femininity and how it's not weak. And I think just because it has a gender name doesn't mean we believe that being a woman is predicated on having a pussy. That's not what we say. It's not what we believe. So yeah, there, and then, I don't know, I think the Pussyhat Project is strong enough to encompass all of that. And we've had some amazing trans knitters join us, and in our manifesto, we talk about being unapologetically feminine. And, you know, that was really aimed toward patriarchy, like not toward like our trans sisters. Like, and I understand that sometimes intention doesn't match the effect, and like we don't want a vulnerable community to feel excluded, you know. So anyway, that's kind of the whole spectrum of different thoughts to your question.
A question.
What the future may be. I see this project being more than just a project, but on the cusp of a movement. And I liked what you said about, you know, women being supportive of each other. I think oftentimes women are not kind to each other. We've become so competitive trying to be like men that we stop forgetting how to be women. So I just want to know, what is the future towards this project that might really be a movement where women start to be kind to each other? Because I was disappointed when Hillary Clinton didn't win, because I thought it was important to have a woman as our president, and yet so many other women did not vote for her, and that was the shocker. So what is the future so that we can be kind to each other?
Yeah. But I think something I would love to start spreading is, the question I get a lot right now is, how do I get a pussy hat? And what? How do I get a pussy hat? Like, where can I get one? Can you give me a pussy hat? Like, that's the question I personally get, the website gets, like, the focus is on the pussy hat. And I would love to shift that question to, what can I do for the women's movement? What can I do politically? What can I do to self-organize? And I think the beginnings of that are there, but to shepherd it more strongly in that direction.
A last question here from the back.
Can I ask two numbers? How long does it take to make a pussy hat?
And
how many are there?
Wait, we have a Barnard student in the audience who experimentally did that this afternoon to be able to answer that question.
I made this one today in class, and I started this one when I got here.
And you? So 37 and a half minutes, you can materialize a symbol.
Also, I don't know how many hats are out there. Maybe a million?
I don't know. So listen, I want to thank you all so much for being here. Wait, Akota, we have students who have something very special for Krista.